Hello everybody, welcome back to another video. And in this video we are going to talk about how you can set up Drizzle ORM with Next.js App Router with server actions, in which we are going to use Drizzle ORM. So let's not waste any time and let's get into it. So on the screen you can see I have a contact form. Now this contact form comes from my previous video about recapture v3 in Next.js. You can go check that out, but I removed recapture from this one. We simply have a contact form, and if you submit this, it's not going to do anything, but we are going to add this functionality. So when you submit this, it will be added. This entire contact info will be added to our database, which will be of course through Drizzle ORM. And on this page you can view the responses and you can also remove them. So that's what we are going to implement. Our main focus in this is going to be using Drizzle ORM. So I will be going a little bit fast on the server actions and all that stuff. Getting started, so this is how our project looks like right now. It's a simple home page that we have, which simply contains the contact form and then a link to the responses page. And in the contact form component, we only have just a form tag with the h2n, all the inputs. And over here, if you go to the responses page, you're going to find we have some responses, right? This is a dummy response. And all we do is we render out all the responses over here. And we have this component that does rendering of one particular response for us. And we receive it in the props, right? So that's the basic overview of how the project is right now. Now let's start setting up Drizzle ORM. So the first step is to open up the terminal, and let's open up a new terminal. So if you go to the official Drizzle docs, you're going to find that we have three databases supported at the moment, and support for SQL Server is also coming soon. So whatever database you are going to use, you have to choose that. So for example, in our case, we are going to go very straightforward SQLite database, and there are many options, right? In our case, it's just one file that we are going to use. So this is the right one, Better SQLite 3. So let's select that. Now we need to install these dependencies. First off, these two dependencies. So let's copy this. Let's go over here and paste. So it seems like there is a conflict between the dependencies. Now it happens time to time. You can use a different package manager like pnpm, but we are going to stick with npm and rerun this same command with this flag of legacy peer depths, and that should hopefully fix this problem. Now while this is getting installed, we also need to install Drizzle kit, right? But as a dev dependency, because we want to run migrations and a configuration file and all that stuff. So let's copy this. Now we are going to install Drizzle kit, but also you remember we installed the Better SQLite 3. Now that does not come with types. So if you're using TypeScript, we also need to install types / Better SQLite 3, both as dev dependencies. All right, so that's done. Now let's go over here and let's create a new file called drizzle.config.ts. Now we have a ts file because we are inside of a TypeScript project, but you can go with js or mjs or whatever. So we are going to export default a function called define config. Now where do you import this? We can just simply import something from Drizzle kit, and we are going to import define config. Now here you have an object. Now here is where you pass in the configuration of your database. In our case, it's going to be just one file. So let's go ahead and, so if you press control space, you're going to get all these options. First off, we need the dialect, right? So in our dialect, we are going to choose SQLite. You can choose any one of them as per your requirement. And then we are going to have the DB credentials. So that is going to be an object, which will take in a URL or much more stuff if you want to pass it in, but we want only the URL, which will simply be our file. So let's just name it db.sqlite3. Now generally you want this to be an environment variable, so let's copy this and go ahead and create a .env file, and we are simply going to create an environment variable that will be database URL dbsqlite3. This file will be created automatically. Now here we need to use process.env. And let's copy and paste this name. It says it could be undefined as well. So let's just, go ahead and add an if check. So if not this, then we are simply going to throw a new error with no db URL found. All right, great. Now to also access the environment variables, we have to install one more dependency. So let's go ahead and install .env as a dev dependency, because Next.js already includes it for itself, but this is outside of Next.js, right? This configuration file. So once you have .env installed, we can simply go ahead and import .env/config, and that's going to set up the configuration for us. All right, so that's half of it. Now what we are going to do is we are going to go ahead and create the database. So inside the source folder, that's what I usually like to do. You can go ahead and not have the source folder as well, but in this app we are going to use the source folder. You can create a new folder called db, and inside db I'm going to create a new file called schemas.ts. This is going to include all of our tables. All right, so let's go ahead and create a table. In our case, if you go to the response item or just the contact form itself, you're going to find out that we need the name, right, from the user, we need the email, and we need the message. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to export const, and let's call this responses, right? That's our table name. Let's create a SQLite table. Now this comes from Drizzle SQLite core, right? We need to give it a name. Let's call this responses, and then we give it what columns we are going to have. First off, every table has a primary key, so let's add an ID, which should be of type integer, right? And make sure to import from the right one. In our case, it's SQLite, right? So integer, the column name will be ID, and it's going to be primary key, and automatically it's going to update itself. So we have the integer, and then we are going to have the name, which will be of type text, right? Text comes from SQLite. That will be name, and let's add a not null over here because it's necessary. Then again, email, same thing, text, email, not null, and message will be text, message, and not null. Now that's basically our table. You can also go ahead and add another unique constraint on your email, but in a contact form like this we don't want this, so let's just remove it. All right, great. So we have the responses table, and now what we can do is go over to our configuration file, and now we can generate migrations. So how do we go about doing that? So if you go down here, once you have the DB credentials, you can specify the folder for schema. So let's just go ahead and specify where our schemas live. Our schemas are in source db schemas.ts. So let's just say source db schemas.ts, and let's also specify a dot slash just in case. And then to generate our migrations, we can specify the out folder that will be inside of source db migrations. So we are going to have a folder called migrations where all of our database migrations will exist. So that's it for our configuration file. We are done with this. Let's go over to the package.json, and let's go over to the scripts, and we can just simply go ahead and say db generate, all right? And we're going to run the command of drizzle git generate. Now what this is going to do is it's going to run drizzle git generate, which will basically take our schemas and it's going to generate migrations for all our schemas. So it's going to generate the SQL for the responses table. And then let's add one more script, that will be db migrate, right? Migrate, and that will be drizzle git migrate. This is going to generate the migrations, this is going to apply the migrations. So whatever migrations we have, it's going to run them one by one. So if you have like 10 migrations, if you made 10 changes to your database, it's going to run all those 10 migrations whenever you run this command. Okay, great. Now let's go ahead and open up our terminal, and we are going to run the first command, that is db generate. So let's just say npm run db generate, and if you look over here, it takes our config file and it creates the migration. So it's over here, you see it generated raw SQL for our database. Now let's go ahead and say npm run db migrate, right? So that is going to run our migration, and it's going to give us this file called db.sqlite3, which we specified in our .env. Also make sure to add .env inside of your gitignore so that it does not get commit to git. Let's also add our db file in here, so we can just say .star.sqlite3, so that's going to ignore all the SQLite files. Okay, great. So we have our SQL database, which looks something like this. We have a table with all the columns. Perfect. Now that we have generated our tables and all that stuff is done, let's go ahead and use actually Drizzle. So in the DB folder itself, I'm going to create an index.ts file. And in here, I am going to set up our database for Next.js. So if you go to the docs again, this is how the setup is going to look like. So let's simply copy this first off. We can go over here and we can paste it. We don't need this last line, but all we need is this. So you have Drizzle, then you have the database from better SQLite 3. And you just create a new database and give it to Drizzle. That's it. But you have to pass in the path of your database. So in our case, it's process.env.database URL, perfect. And we have our db over here, so we can just simply export const db. Amazing, that's pretty much it. Now let's go ahead and use Drizzle ORM. First, we are going to use it to submit our contact form. And remember, for this db, we don't really have access to it on the front end because Drizzle runs on the back end or on the server only. So we are going to create a server action in Next.js 13. So let's go over to the app folder and I'm going to create an actions.ts file. This is where our server actions will live. First off, we are going to mark it with use server, of course. And then for the contact form, so if you look at the contact form, we have these three inputs and that's and one text area, right? So two inputs and one text area. So we're going to export an async function, contact us action, let's call it that. And in here, we are going to get the form data, which will be form data like this. Or you can go ahead and add form validation with Zod or anything like that. But we are going to stick with normal stuff right now because this video is already very long. So let's go ahead and make this work. Now, first off, let's just go ahead and say await db, and db comes from this index.ts file, right? So db is this db. So we say db.insert, and we are going to insert into which table? If you remember, we insert into the responses table, all right? So we are going to insert into responses that again gets imported. And we are going to give it the values of passing an object. First thing is the name. So the name is going to be form data dot get name. All right. And then we are going to have the email, which will be form data dot get email. And then the message is going to be form data dot get message. All right. Now TypeScript throws us an error because form data dot get returns you this, but we know it's going to be string. So we can just go ahead and say as string. And that's why I said you should use some sort of validation. All right, so we just do a db insert, and you can also handle errors depending on your database. So in our case, it's better SQLite 3. We can basically go ahead and wrap this inside of try catch. So let's say try and catch, and here we get the error. So in our case, we are going to have a SQLite error, right? It's from better SQLite 3. So we can simply go ahead and check if error is instance of SQLite error. And this actually comes from better SQLite 3. So we can go ahead and simply import SQLite error. And you can say if that is the error, we can return success of false and error will be error.message. All right, hit save. And again, once we are done adding our responses, what we are going to do is outside of here, let's just redirect to our responses page. Now, the reason I put redirect outside the try and catch is because redirect itself is going to throw an error. So you should never go ahead and put redirect over here. It should always be outside of any try block. Okay, so coming back to our contact form, what we can do here is simply go ahead and add action equals to our contact us action. You can add more stuff like loading state and all that, but I guess you can do all that yourself. It's very straightforward. So coming to our front end, let's just go ahead and say the name is going to be Usman, the email is going to be usman@example.com, and in the message let's just say I want to contact you and hit submit. Now that is going to redirect us to the responses page, which means that it has been added to Drizzle. So let's go over here and let's check our DB SQLite 3. If you go check for responses and let's just click on this. So you see we have one row. Perfect. Now let's go over to the responses page over here. We no longer need all these things, and let's create a function. So I'm going to create an async function that will be get responses. All right. And that is simply going to return await db, again comes from that file dot select. We're going to select from the responses. All right, let's just say responses, and that's it, db select from responses. And we can go over here and we can make this async because this is a React server component, and we get the RSP responses from get responses. Now the reason I named it like this is because responses is already this name that we imported. So let's just name it different. Then we can do this length, and then we map over it and we get each response. Also, let's rename this to like this, and we pass it into response item. Now in the response item, we manually type this out. Instead, what we can do is we can go over to our schemas right over here, and we can export a type called response select that will be equal to type of responses dot infer select, that is by Drizzle. So now we go back to our response item and we no longer need this. We can just say it's going to be response select, right? Response select that comes from DB schemas. All right, so that seems it. Let's go back and you see we get one response coming from our database. Great. Let's go ahead and add one more. I am going to this time fill this form with random data, hit submit. You see we get the other response. Now let's work on deleting this. Again, fairly straightforward. We can go to actions and let's create one more action, export async function, remove response. All right, it's not going to take in anything except the ID of the response, which will be of type number, because in our database we have number. And again, let's just have a normal try catch, and this will be our error handling. And let's go ahead and just say await db.delete, and we're going to delete from the responses table, where now we can use Drizzle's equals helper. So we have equals responses.id is equal to whatever ID we get over here. And that's not it, because now we also need to reload the data, right? Refetch the data. So over here we can just say revalidate path, and we can revalidate the path of slash responses. So basically this page. Okay, now let's use this. Let's go back to our response item. Inside of this button, this is what we want to use, right? This X button. So how do we do it? We can either make this a client component and then use on click on our button. But here's a technique if you just want to quickly test things out, right? So you can just take this button, you can create a form tag, and then inside this form just keep the button, and let's give it a type of submit anyways, type of submit. So this form, we are going to simply add an action, and it will be remove response. Now in here it gives us an error, because if you look over here, we take the ID as number and action gives us the form data type, right? Just like we took over here. So the types don't really match. So in this case, there is a small workaround. If you go to the official Next.js docs, in here you're going to find this passing additional arguments, and this is how you do it, right? So in this case, you use the bind method, right? And you bind simply another variable inside the server action, and that gives you a new server action. And that's just how it works with Next.js at the moment. So in our case, we can do the same thing. Let's just create const remove response with ID, because we are passing in the ID, right? And that is going to be equal to remove response dot bind. And the first argument is null, and the second argument is response.id. Alright, so we get our new action over here, which we can just pass it in. Otherwise, you can make it a client component and handle it separately. But hopefully, you learned something new today. Alright, so let's come back over here and let's say I want to delete this response. Let's click on delete, and it got deleted. Great. And our data also refreshed. If you go check our database over here in the responses table, you'll find that we only have one. Let's test this out again. If I go back over here, fake filler, fill this form, hit submit. We are on this page. Let's fake filler, fill this form. Let's just fill all inputs, hit submit. We get it again, and let's delete all of them. Perfect. So that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something from it. Leave a like if this helped you out. And if you have any questions, anything to ask, ask it in the comments below. I'll try my best to help you out. Also, the code is available on GitHub, so you can go check that out. Until then, bye and have a good time.